Welcome to A Look Ahead. We're delighted that you've decided to join us. You probably know by now that we study the Sabbath school lessons as prepared by the Seventh-day Adventist Church. And this particular series is on the Holy Spirit and spirituality. And this is lesson number 8 in that series for February 25 of 2017, entitled The Holy Spirit and the Gifts of the Spirit. Now, last week we talked about the fruit of the Spirit, but this week it's the gifts of the Spirit. What would those be? Well, that's what we're going to find out. So let's begin with a word of prayer as we open our Bibles and learn more about these things. Our wonderful Father, gifts. What does that mean? What kind of gifts do you want to give us? What are those gifts supposed to do for us or in us? Help us to understand the way in which you, through your Holy Spirit, are able to work with us, and may we be willing and able is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen. There are a couple of very famous verses in Matthew 28, 19 and 20. Look at those for just a moment. Go then and to all peoples everywhere and make them my disciples. Baptize them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, and teach them to obey everything I have commanded you. And I will be with you always to the end of the age. Did Jesus give them a clear task in those verses? Do you think the disciples at that point in time, which is just as he's about to send back to heaven, do you think the disciples at that point had any idea what Jesus, or even just maybe a little teensy part of an idea of what he had in mind when he said that to all the world?
They had no idea what the world was. The new world wasn't even found until 1,400 years later.
Yeah.
Well, it sounds like you just said, keep going.
Yeah.
Keep going.
Well, what's incredible, it took 3.5 more years for them camped around Jerusalem before terrible persecution broke out, and they finally said, oh, I guess we better run away from the persecution, and they started spreading the gospel. Amazing. Well, but already on Pentecostal Sunday, Jesus had given them the means for accomplishing the task. The Holy Spirit that was given and descended on that day in the form of flames of fire was, in turn, commissioned to give gifts to God's church. Well, we've already talked about the fruit of the Spirit. We suggested last week that the fruit of the Spirit is based on love. What does love have to do with the gifts of the Spirit?
Everything,
yeah. So, in contrast to the fruit of the Spirit, which is singular, just one, there are many different spiritual gifts, some of which are more important than others. Look at one of the lists in 1 Corinthians chapter 12, verses 4 to 7 and verse 11. There are different kinds of spiritual gifts, but the same Spirit gives them. There are different ways of serving, but the same Lord is served. There are different abilities to perform service, but the same God gives ability to all for their particular service. The Spirit's presence is shown in some way in each person for the good of all. What's the purpose of the gifts? What does it mean when it says for the good of all? Dropping down to verse 11, but it is one and the same Spirit who does all this as he wishes. He gives a different gift to each person. Do some people have more than one gift?
Yes.
It seems so. But every person has at least one gift. And it's possible that if you make good use of the one gift you have, God might actually give you more gifts to expand your capacity. Well, God recognized that a growing organization such as the church needed and still needs a variety of talents and gifts to make it run smoothly and to help it to grow. Thus, he gave and continues to give the gifts of the Spirit. We all need to recognize, however, that without the fruit of the Spirit, the gifts of the Spirit would be useless. It is very interesting to note also that love, which comes at the beginning of the list of the fruit of the Spirit, and maybe is the core of the fruit of the Spirit, is also an important part of the gifts of the Spirit. Notice that 1 Corinthians 12 and 1 Corinthians 14, the two main chapters in the Bible that talk about the gifts of the Spirit, what chapter is sandwiched between those two chapters on the gifts?
Love.
1 Corinthians 13, the love chapter, right? Well, furthermore, in Ephesians 4, 11 to 13, another discussion of the gifts of the Spirit is followed by Ephesians 4, 15 and 16 with further references to love. Romans 12, 3 to 8, another mention of the gifts of the Spirit is followed by more verses about love, verses 9 and 10. In fact, love is an integral part of both the fruit of the Spirit, Galatians 5, 22 and 23, and the gifts of the Spirit, 1 Corinthians 12, 31 and 13, 13. Let's just look at those verses really quick again. 1 Corinthians 12, 31, after he's talked about the gifts of the Spirit for a while, he says, set your hearts then on the more important gifts, best of all. Would that be the best gift of all? Probably. Best of all, however, is the following way, and then he talks about love. And then when you come to the end of that chapter, what does he say? Meanwhile, these three remain, faith, hope, and love, and the greatest of these is love, right?
Now, when, if the Lord came down and said that, I'm going to give you a gift of the Spirit, what would come into your mind that you might get? And since everybody gets different gifts, what kind of thing would it be?
I mean, that's a good question. We're going to read in this lesson there are quite a number of different gifts. And it's pretty clear in the Bible that He decides what gift you're going to get.
But we can desire.
Yes.
We don't have it up. 1 Corinthians 14, 1.
Yeah. It's there.
Yeah. But especially that desire earnestly spiritual gifts, but especially that you may prophesy. So I don't know that we just get a gift and then say, well, what should I do with this? It's more like we encounter the world and we say, there are needs here and what can I do? And God gives us gifts to.
Do you know any prophets?
I think any of us can prophesy at any time. We can speak God's word.
Yeah.
We don't have to be designated as a prophet.
You don't have to be able to foretell the future or something like that to be a prophet. The word prophet comes from two different Greek expressions. Pro means for or on behalf of, and phemi means to speak. So a prophet is someone who speaks on behalf of God. So could every one of us be prophets? In fact, I am convinced based on my understanding of our key verses, you know, Revelation 12, 17, Revelation 14, 12, and Revelation 19, 10, especially the 19, 10 verse, that in fact, it's God's plan for all of His people, whoever they end up being at the end, the very end, all of them will speak out with a collective voice, as in a kind of prophecy, to the end time people of the world.
I remember studying with a brother in Ephesians where it lists the gifts, and he remarked that he thought preaching was, or prophesying was preaching. And at first, I thought that kind of, considering some of the preaching I'd heard, that sort of cheapened prophecy. And then I remembered a story that H.M.S. Richard Sr. Told about his father. His father was pastoring in Loveland, Colorado around the turn, about 1900. And he got up to speak one Sabbath, and who should be in the audience but Ellen White? Well, he was the prophet of the church, so he approached her and he says, Ellen, or Sister White, would you like to speak? And this was her response. Brother Richards, did you ask God for a message? Yes. And did He give you one? Yes. And did you pray over it? Yes. Well, then I want to hear it.
So very good.
So that's, all preaching should be prophesying, not that it is. But
very good. Thank you for that insight. Well, if the Holy Spirit is given by Jesus to carry on the work of Jesus after the ascension, wouldn't that work involve Jesus? So my question obviously is, what's the role, what's the relationship of Jesus to the gifts of the Spirit? Well, he says, I'm going to give you the best possible gift. And what was that? The Holy Spirit, right? And that Holy Spirit, in turn, apparently is the one who gives us these other gifts.
All the blessings in his train, or his train.
Mm-hmm. So as we look around the world, we must recognize that different people have different natural abilities. What's the relationship between those natural innate abilities, or we sometimes call them talents, and spiritual gifts? Are spiritual gifts just some kind of special kind of talent, or?
The way I look at spiritual gifts, I look at the gift of how we're going to express love in this world.
Mm-hmm.
And those are going to be determined by two different components. One is our individuality.
Mm-hmm.
Not two of us are alike.
Mm-hmm.
Therefore, we are all going to express love in different ways.
Okay.
And therefore, I have a gift that no one else has, but same is true of every one of us.
Yeah.
On the other hand, the education we have also influences how we use our gift of the Spirit or love
mm-hmm.
for others. Mm-hmm. You are a doctor. You mm-hmm. express it by healing people. Others do it by preaching. Others do it by teaching. Others mm-hmm. do it in various ways.
Mm-hmm.
But those are the two components that determine our gifts, essentially, individuality and the kind of education we have.
Okay. Could a person with some kind of natural talent, could that talent be used by God as a kind of spiritual gift?
Of course.
Yeah, absolutely. God doesn't mind using our natural talents when that's appropriate. Well, let's look at a few verses to really sort of get a feel for this. This is what Paul says about the gifts. For the body itself is not made up of only one part, but of many parts. If the foot were to say, because I'm not a hand, I don't belong to the body, that would not keep it from being a part of the body. And if the ear were to say, oh, because I'm not an eye, I don't belong to the body, that would not keep it from being a part of the body. If the whole body were just an eye, how could it hear? And if it were only an ear, how could it smell? As it is, however, God put every different part in the body just as he wanted it to be. There would not be a body if it were all only one part. As it is, there are many parts but one body. So then the eye cannot say to the hand, I don't need you. Nor can the head say to the feet, well, I don't need you. On the contrary, we cannot do without the parts of the body that seem to be weaker. And those parts that we think aren't worth very much are the ones which we treat with greater care, while the parts of the body which don't look very nice, whichever those were, are treated with special modesty, which the more beautiful parts do not need. God himself has put the body together in such a way as to give greater honor to those parts that need it. And so there is no division in the body, but all its different parts have the same concern for one another. If one part of the body suffers, and the other parts suffer with it, all the other parts suffer with it. If one part is praised, all the other parts share its happiness. All of you are Christ's body, and each one is a part of it. In the church, God has put all in place. In the first place, apostles, in the second place, prophets, and in the third place, teachers, then those who perform miracles, followed by those who are given the power to heal or to heal, help others to direct them or to speak in strange tongues. They are not all apostles or prophets or teachers. Not everyone has the power to work miracles or to heal diseases or to speak in strange tongues or to explain what is said. Set your heart then on the more important gifts, and then guess what? Paul talks about love.
You kind of notice, though, that when you have all these gifts making up a body, that's kind of a community or mm-hmm. a social thing that comes together where everybody loves each other,
mm-hmm.
and then all these talents come together and they even amplify even more than a single talent could do.
Right.
So. Love your neighbor, it works in there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. So basically, once again, what you're saying really is that every gift is supposed to be for the benefit of the whole group. Mm-hmm. This isn't something of, look what I've got, you know, I'm special, I'm different, I'm better than everybody else, I've got this gift, this talent, this whatever.
Yeah, you know, there is a gift of leadership too,
mm-hmm.
you know, and a leader is at the head, but if they're humble enough, you know, they will do their job well.
Mm-hmm.
You know? I think it's important to realize that the gifts we have can be used different ways.
Mm-hmm.
Think of the Apostle Paul, who had an amazing gift for zeal. And he
for
used
sure.
it to crucify Christians. Then the same zeal were later on used to prosper mm-hmm. the word of Christ.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very much so. Do you think you can recognize spiritual gifts in other members of your church?
See, this is where spiritual gifts takes all of its importance, because spiritual implies love.
Mm-hmm.
So what is a spiritual gift? It's a loving, a gift that reproduces love,
mm-hmm.
whereas all the others, if they don't represent love, they're not spiritual.
Yeah.
Love builds, yeah. Knowledge inflates.
Mm-hmm.
Looks bigger than, but love edifies or builds up. So are we building up or are we trying to cloister ourselves?
Yes.
Can we recognize a spiritual gift in ourselves? Or is that dangerous?
Anything that is destructive, we should be able to recognize to a certain extent, and that cannot be love.
Mm-hmm. I know
we should focus on the constructive side.
Yeah.
There are, you can have a group that could have a guy move in and actually destroy everything too. Mm. So, you know, there's people in the church even that will actually hinder the church by blowing all this up. And they don't even know it. They might even think that they're doing a good cause, mm. when in fact they're separating everybody.
Mm-hmm. I know a lady who really didn't think she had any gifts, any spiritual gifts. But in fact, she was very good at teaching. And one day they had in church, they had a little sort of a focus group, and she was sitting there, and they said, you know, she said, well, I don't really know what I can do. And they said, what do you mean you don't know what you can do? You're a great teacher. Oh, okay. So she started exercising her spiritual gift and did a good job of it.
I wonder if there's any gifts that just you discover once you become a Christian, once you believe in Jesus, that if something new comes from that. I think it does happen.
Yeah.
It'd be interesting.
There's obviously a huge variety of views about the purpose of spiritual gifts. According to the Bible, spiritual gifts are given for service, not for personal sanctification, not to prove that you're come some kind of a super saint or identifying you as special in some way or other. They're not given for the entertainment of the organization. Furthermore, they're not given to fulfill our own spiritual needs or to prove that we are a member of the church. Such a view of the gifts of the Holy Spirit would suggest that the gifts are more Christian-centered than they are Christ-centered. What is your view of spiritual gifts? Do they focus more on Christians or more on God? That's a serious part of this discussion. I have suggested in the past my own sort of breakdown of these things. I think the Holy Spirit functions at four different levels, and sometimes we get confused because we mix up these levels. The first level is He keeps us alive. If God removed His power from us, we would just die. The second level at which He operates is, we sometimes call it wooing. He tries to attract people, to draw them into God's kingdom. The third level at which he operates is where he actually convicts people and says, you know, yes, now is the time for you to step forward and you know, exhibit your faith, your trust, proclaim yourself a Christian, be baptized if necessary, whatever. And then the fourth level at which he operates is the giving of gifts. He says, now that you've become a church member, now that you're committed to this, let me give you a gift, let me encourage you to use a gift that will build up the body of the church. And I find those four levels to be helpful for me. If they would be helpful to any of you, why, that's my suggestion. Look at another place where it talks about the gifts and the building up of the gifts in Ephesians 4, starting with verse 11. It was he who gave gifts. He appointed some to be apostles, others to be prophets, others to be evangelists, others to be pastors and teachers. He did this to prepare all God's people for the work of Christian service in order to build up the body of Christ. Now notice it's always the same. The purpose of it's for what? To build up the body of Christ. And so we shall all come together. That's what happens if the church is built up. All come together that to that oneness in our faith and in our knowledge of the Son of God, we shall become mature people, reaching to the very height of Christ's full stature. Then we shall no longer be children carried by the waves and blown about by every shifting wind of the teaching of deceitful people who lead others into error by the tricks they invent. Instead, by speaking the truth in a spirit of love, there's our love again, we must grow up in every way to Christ, who is the head. Under his control, all the different parts of the body fit together, and the whole body is held together by every joint with which it is provided. So when each separate part works as it should, the whole body grows and builds itself up through love once again. So that would be, imagine belonging to an organization where that was really happening, where those...
The unity of faith he's talking about is unity in love.
Mm-hmm, yeah. The Revised English Bible, or the New English Bible before that, in translating that verse, did something which I think was really wonderful. I wish more translations had done this. The unity that is inherent in our faith. That's the way they translate it. In other words, if we have a common love for God, a common relationship with God, that thing we call faith, as a group, love is just a natural part of that. You get together with people who share that kind of a commitment to the gospel and so forth, you have a natural bond. So I think it's something that's inherent, and absolutely inherent right there in the very nature of it.
State of at-one-ment.
Yeah, a state of at-one-ment, yeah. Look at 1 Corinthians 14, verse 1. It is love, then, that you should strive for. Set your hearts on spiritual gifts, especially the gift of proclaiming God's message. So what's the relationship between love and proclaiming God's message? Are we successful about reaching out to others if we're not loving?
Why we reach out. That's why, because we love.
Yeah. Yeah.
How can speak we God's teach something word. We don't understand ourselves?
Exactly.
Now, when a person comes out to start preaching, mm-hmm. how is the audience going to know that person when he starts, that he has love that would attract
genuine.
Them? What's that?
Genuine love.
Genuine love.
Yeah.
As opposed to...
Is it in his words?
See, love is not something we do, something we are. And that's mm-hmm. where the problem comes in.
Yeah.
Okay, but what gives the person the indication that you have that love? What is it?
Well, if you're thinking in terms of a preacher, I would say he would have to speak the word. He would have to correctly represent Scripture. Now, we are told that it's not our job to judge people. But it's absolutely our job to judge the truth.
It's a message.
So if that person is giving a message and you know it's not in agreement with Scripture,
it's not love.
It's not loving, and you have a perfect right to reject it. On the other hand, if it clearly is from Scripture, it's clearly representing the Scripture, then we should accept it. we make a judgment and we say, yes, that's the truth.
It's okay to reject the message,
yeah,
but it's never okay to reject the person,
right,
who carries that message. Mm-hmm. And that's where love comes in, to be able to reject somebody's way of thinking while loving that person. Now, that's what Jesus was able to,
yeah,
was capable, mm-hmm, of doing.
He wept over the Pharisees.
He sure did.
There's a saying that gold is where you find it, and when somebody steps up to preach, you'd like to think that they have the love that comes from God. But there have been times, like with Balaam, who gave a messianic prophecy, and yet he turned around, mm-hmm, and did terrible things. And you have Caiaphas, who said that it's expedient that one man should die, and that the whole nation shouldn't perish. And he didn't say that in love, but John then explains in his gospel that he didn't say this of his own initiative. He said it because he was high priest that year, that Christ would die not only for the nation, but for the whole world. So
Caiaphas' idea was not that it was going to damage all the people out there in the world, it would destroy their government.
Right.
And that's what that's the only thing he cared about.
Right. He didn't understand what, yeah, he was saying.
Did he really care about that, or was that his excuse?
Well, he was driven by pride.
Yeah.
That's,
yeah,
right, the difference between Christ and Caiaphas. One is driven by love, the other one by pride.
Yeah.
But what I'm saying is that if he was protecting his own position,
yeah,
that would be the first thing he'd do,
yeah,
is say,
exactly,
that the government, we've got to keep everything the way it is, you know.
And he was afraid that if Jesus kept at it, that the Romans would come and take things away.
Yeah.
Or even that Jesus would become king.
Yeah. Well, I think he was more concerned with the Romans coming.
Yeah. Well, there are some Christians who say, well, we shouldn't waste our time talking about spiritual gifts because that was the times of Jesus and the apostles. No more spiritual gifts. Is that true?
No.
Well, I think you read in Ephesians 4 what the gifts are for, and it's, mm-hmm, to build us up and till we achieve to the full maturity. And I can't say that we're fully mature just yet.
Yeah.
Well,
exactly. That's the point. They use 1 Corinthians 13:10, where it says, when the perfect comes, the partial will be done away. Well, that's exactly the point, as you just pointed out. Has the perfect come yet? What perfect is he talking about? He's talking about the second coming of Jesus. Do we see him here in front of us? No. So it hasn't come yet. We still desperately need those gifts, and we need people who are willing to use those gifts to build up, you know, the body of Christ.
And we need one another in this process,
mm-hmm,
because all of us have flaws,
mm-hmm,
in our thinking. So by putting on the table all of the thoughts that come through, including the ones that may be false,
yeah,
ultimately the truth will come out of this,
yeah,
exchange.
Yeah, exactly. We haven't talked about the latter rain yet, but if you are familiar with that part of the world, you know that the early rains, which seem late to us because they come in November and December, but to them that's after the planting season. The early rains come in November and December. Then the latter rains are much bigger and much heavier, come in like March, April, May, and into June. Those are heavier rains. So do you think that the former rains, in the times of the apostles especially, we're going to be greater than what will happen in the latter rain in our day? Are we really going to be looking forward to the day when the Holy Spirit will be poured out with unbelievable power?
Yes. The latter rain should be stronger than the former rain, because,
yeah,
it will bring the fruit. It will bring the fruition.
Mm-hmm. Well, so do we need to? Are there any warnings that we need to be aware of when we talk about the gifts of the Spirit? Do they need to be tested in some way?
Oh, yes.
Do they edify? Do they build up?
Look at a few verses. 1 Corinthians 12, verse 10. This is one of the chapters that talks about the gifts. The Spirit gives one person the power to work miracles, to another the gift of speaking God's message, and to yet another the ability to tell the difference between gifts that come from the Spirit and those that do not. To one person he gives the ability to speak in strange tongues, and to another he gives the ability to explain what is said. So, who has the ability to tell the difference between gifts that come from the Spirit and those that do not? Well, let's look at a couple of other places. Look at 1 Corinthians 14:29. Two or three who are given God's message should speak, while the others are to judge what they say. So what's like we said, it's not our job to judge other people, but it's certainly our job to carefully evaluate what they say and find out whether it's really the truth. Probably the most potent verse in this respect is 1 John chapter 4, the first three verses. My dear friends, do not believe all who claim to have the Spirit, but test them to find out if the Spirit they have comes from God. For many false prophets have gone out everywhere, and this was back in John's day. This is how you will be able to know whether it is God's Spirit. Anyone who acknowledges that Jesus Christ came as a human being has a spirit who comes from God. But anyone who denies this about Jesus does not have the Spirit from God. The Spirit that he has is from the enemy of Christ. He heard that it would come, and now it is here in the world already. That was a huge issue back in John's day. Is that still an issue in our day? How many people out there really believe that Jesus was born miraculously, that he died a cruel death, that he rose on the third day and went back to heaven? How many people really believe that?
Minority.
Yeah, certainly a minority. So we need to be testing everything. We also know that Satan will exercise false gifts, especially as the history of this world comes to an end. I mean, for him it's curtains, isn't it? If this world comes to an end, it's all over for him. Now there's going to be a 1,000-year millennium, but he knows that's it. There's no going back. But if he can keep us from focusing on the truth, from becoming like Jesus, he can go on living. Go on practicing all his cruelty and all his, you know, lording it over people and so forth. So we need to become very discerning. And what's the best way to become discerning? To tell the truth from the falsehood?
Study the word.
You have to know, and the classic example we've often used is counterfeiting currency. You know, if you gave a young child, said, here's a square piece of paper, a rectangular piece of paper about the right size, here's a green crayon, make a dollar bill or make a $5 bill, and he scribbles on it, and you go down to the store and you try to buy something, what are they going to do? They're going to laugh at you, right? But suppose you got the right kind of cloth or the right kind of paper, which is partly cloth, and you got the right kind of machine, and you got the right kind of ink, and you did everything just right. You're a professional counterfeiter. And you took that down to the store. What are the chances that they might actually accept it? So the closer the false is to the true, the more dangerous it can become. And that will be the case in the end, because Satan is going to come with false teachings, false prophecy, lying visions, counterfeit tongue speaking, occult healing powers, misleading signs and wonders. Just some of the things mentioned in the scriptures that are coming. Well, we've talked about certain Christian groups that have this belief that in order to be a real church member, to be a real Spirit-led person, you have to be able to speak in strange tongues. How would we respond to those people? I used to work in a clinic where most of the, not all the staff, but several of the leading staff in that clinic all believed that they had the power to speak in tongues. And there wasn't much you could say to them. I mean, who are you to tell me? I mean, I speak in tongues, you know?
It does have a tendency to build a certain level of pride.
Yeah.
Which is counterproductive when you consider that pride goes against love.
Mm-hmm.
Well, what's so important about speaking in tongues anyway?
Well, it's a proof that you have the Holy Spirit. Whatever comes out of your mouth is straight from God.
Well, think so. You don't, anybody can make some racket.
Who cares what you think, man? I've got this power to speak in tongues.
That's the temptation there, is if you want to feel like you fit in, it's the easiest one to counterfeit. You can babble off some syllables and stuff and say it's an unknown tongue, or you could go out and learn passages of scripture in another language and quote them, and people say, oh, yeah, you got this.
I sometimes tell the story that was told to me about one of our professors, one of our Adventist universities, back in the days when there was a whole group of the full Gospel Businessmen's Association had decided, I think it was the year 1972, that we're going to make Seventh-day Adventists real Pentecostals. We're gonna give them the power to speak in tongues. And so they called Adventists to come down. They had a big meeting in Boston. And people came down, some Adventists came and said, okay, let's see what's going on here. So before the meeting, it just got going well, and pretty soon people are standing up and babbling away, and someone over there is responding and so forth. And finally, this Adventist professor stood up and said, da-da-da-da-da, and he rattled off quite a speech. And then he sat down, and someone on the other side of the room jumped up and said, oh, thank you, brother, for bringing us a message from God. Here's the interpretation, and he gave this interpretation. And when he was finished, the Adventist professor stood up and he says, I'm actually a professor of ancient languages, and I quoted Isaiah 53 in the original Hebrew, and it doesn't have anything to do with what this guy over here said, and the whole meeting just went
real dapper over the meeting, brother.
Well, we mentioned it already. Do not all speak with tongues, do they? He's rhetorically asking this, and the obvious answer is that no. Not everybody speaks with tongues. So,
Ellen White at different times spoke on the subject of this, and this is two or three different places put together. The man who makes the working of miracles the test of his faith will find that Satan can, through species of deceptions, perform wonders that will appear to be genuine miracles. That was in 1907. Then she wrote, let not the days pass by and precious opportunities be lost of seeking the Lord with all the heart and mind and soul. If we accept not the truth in the love of it, we may be among the number who will see the miracles wrought by Satan in these last days and believe them. Many strange things will appear as wonderful miracles which should be regarded as deceptions manufactured by the father of lies. That was 1906. Men under the influence of evil spirits will work miracles in 1903. Those passages are put together in the book Selected Messages, Book 2, pages 52 and 53, and then in some other places. So if, in fact, the Holy Spirit is continuing to give spiritual gifts to His children, why don't we see miraculous healings today as occurred in biblical times? Does anybody have the gift of miracles today?
In a way, because if we use the words of Ellen White, what does she say is the miracle of miracles? Mm-hmm. She calls conversion the miracle of miracles.
Mm-hmm.
So if we are in any way part of someone's conversion, we have in effect been a part of a miracle of miracles.
The greatest miracle of all. Yeah. Changing someone who is a sinner into a loving child of God. That's an incredible miracle.
Isn't that more important than being healed of blindness or anything else?
I will tell you that I know of two people personally. I know them personally who say that. And these were in remote areas in other parts of the world, not here, in places where people believed in those kinds of things, where they actually claimed they saw someone raised from the dead. Two different places. One was in Bangladesh and one was in the southern part of the Philippines. And I had no reason to doubt their words. Some of you have heard of the book One Miracle After Another. An incredible story of someone's life who grew up in Romania and all that happened to him. And there's other miracles. There are other stories that are written, I'm sure, that are true about miracles. But secondly, there's another reason why God doesn't work like that so much today, because when God starts to perform more and more miracles at the end, guess who's going to duplicate them as far as possible? And God doesn't want, you know, that kind of thing to be confusing people's minds any sooner than necessary.
I like to say that miracles are the signature of God on his message. Mm-hmm. In his day, it was important for him to perform those miracles because he was bringing a message that was so strange to the mm-hmm. ears of those people mm-hmm. that by demonstrating to the world and the universe that he is the creator by replacing a bad eye with a good one and other such things, mm-hmm. he was really putting the signature of the creator on the very message he yeah. was bringing to the world.
Yeah.
So maybe we don't need those miracles as much now. We have the message. Mm-hmm. It is all about love. Let's study it and mm-hmm. grow in that love and be transformed by His grace.
And I'll read you about something from Ellen White about that in just a moment. But think what happened to Moses and Aaron. What happened when they went to Pharaoh and performed miracles? Satan was right there to try to duplicate it as far as possible, right? Well, Ellen White said these words, "The way in which Christ worked was to preach the word and to relieve suffering by miraculous works of healing. But I am instructed that we cannot now work in this way, for Satan will exercise his power by working miracles. God's servants today could not work by means of miracles because spurious works of healing, claiming to be divine, will be wrought. For this reason, the Lord has marked out a way in which his people are to carry forward a work of physical healing combined with the teaching of the word. Sanitariums are to be established, and with these institutions are to be connected workers who will carry forward a genuine medical missionary work. Thus, a guarding influence is thrown around those who come to the sanitariums for treatment." Medical Ministry, page 14, verses paragraphs 2 and 3, and Selected Messages, book 2, page 54. So, we as Adventists have chosen to exercise our healing capacities in other ways. And it seems like it's been a benefit to the world. Well, as you look around at your Sabbath school class or your church, do you see people using their spiritual gifts for the benefit of the entire organization? Is this something we're not, it seems so strange to us that we're not even looking for it?
Some churches have pretty nice singers.
Okay.
They get up in front, and then there are some Sabbath school teachers that are very good.
Mm-hmm.
They actually put in the time to prepare, mm-hmm. and people go to them because mm-hmm. they actually look forward to them. So there's spiritual gifts you can see in a church if you look hard enough.
Okay. Now there's a lot of other. Remember, we listed a whole bunch of them. If we could go back, we could read them. I mean, apostles, prophets, and so forth. By the way, what is an apostle? Do we have apostles today?
Someone who's sent.
To carry a message, right?
Right.
The Latin word for apostle is missionary. We use that word today for people we send overseas. And you don't need to go overseas. I can tell you where there's a place where missionaries are needed about 3 miles from here where I work. So apostles, missionaries, the Greek is apostle, the Latin is missionary. Well, have we recognized our spiritual gift or gifts? Would it be all right to pray to the Holy Spirit saying, "Please help me to recognize the way you want me to exercise whatever talents or abilities I have to build up the church"? Would that be an appropriate prayer?
Well, to make us aware of the needs out there,
mm-hmm.
needs out there that we might be able to meet.
I can tell you in my business that I see a lot of people who are hurting. Really hurting, and not just physically hurting, but mentally and spiritually hurting. And fairly often I pray for people. And very often when you do that for people, they're in tears. I mean, I've seen
grown men that you think just came off of a motorcycle with leather jackets and so forth, and they're in tears when you pray for them. So, I mean, who knows what all that, how all that will work out, but I think it's very appropriate for us to do that when there's an opportunity. So if we do not feel that we have been given any spiritual gift, we become jealous of some others who seem to have spiritual gifts, are we suggesting that God does not know what is best for the church? Now, the scriptures clearly say that everybody has at least one gift. So if we're not sure what our gift is, what are we saying? We just haven't figured out what we're good for yet.
You haven't really tried anything, maybe.
Maybe.
Maybe you haven't jumped in and said, can I help?
Yeah.
You'd be probably surprised what will happen.
The other question is, do we really have to be aware of the gifts we have? Isn't the fact that we touch the hearts of people an indication of a gift? And because we are not self-centered or self-concerned about such things, maybe it flows naturally and we don't even know we have these gifts.
Yeah.
Or we might encounter situations where it's beyond our capacity to respond, and we become like the person who, in Jesus' parable, where the traveler came and this man had nothing to give to him to feed, so he went to his mm-hmm. neighbor. And if we think of God as our neighbor, you know, give me something to give to this person. And that might be something that he could, a word that he could give to us to speak to this person, or maybe direct them to other resources, or you mm-hmm. might just be overwhelmed with, you know, as a young person, with certain medical things and decide I should become a doctor or yeah. a nurse or whatever, and that process would take much longer to complete. But it's always, there's a cycle of what are the needs out there and how can I respond, and then the growth, and then you meet those needs, and then there's other ones, and mm-hmm. so it just goes yep. over and over if you actually love the people out there and you want to meet their needs.
Let me read one of the other passages in Scripture where it talks about the gifts. This is Ephesians 4. I'm going to read starting with verse 11. It was he who gave gifts. He appointed some to be apostles. Now, I want you to think for just a moment. If you were the one choosing which gift you wanted, which one of these would you want? Apostles, others to be prophets, others to be evangelists, others to be pastors and teachers. Pastors and teachers apparently go together. He did this to prepare all God's people for the work of Christ's service in order to build up the body of Christ. So that's one of the shorter lists. Which one of those do you think you would rather be, or you'd rather have? Okay, it's apostles, prophets, evangelists, pastors and teachers.
The one most needed for the circumstances.
The one most needed. Yeah. And any, I mean, you could see, I think everyone here can see a time, a place or a time when each one of those would be exactly what's needed.
And sometimes we're told that God would give us the words.
Mm-hmm.
Well, that doesn't mean we are always a preacher, but in certain situations
yeah.
we might be given just the words we need.
Well, what if you were given, if we go to one of these other places where it talks about gifts, what if you were given the gift of helps? How would you use that?
Of what?
Helps.
Helps?
Helps.
Is that a noun?
I'm just telling you what the scripture says. Or the gift of healing. Is it only doctors who have the gift of healing?
Is the body the only thing that needs to be healed?
Yeah, what about that?
The teacher and the preacher has a job to do there. That's
what about
the thinking of the about God.
One of the other gifts that's mentioned is hospitality. Are we good at hospitality? And the gift of generosity. Is it only rich people who can be generous? And what about the gift of administration? That mean you get to be in charge?
Well, you appear to be in charge.
You appear to be in charge, yeah. What would happen to it? I mean, does every church need to have all of the gifts? I know some of these are challenging questions.
We would do better the more we had, of course, mm-hmm. but even people who, Paul uses the body as an example of the various functions, there are people mm-hmm. who lose a limb or maybe several limbs, and they still have ability to function in some way, and so mm-hmm. people rise to the occasion. And God can work through whoever he has available.
One of my teachers back in medical school was working and doing research back in the early days when they didn't recognize the hazards so much of radiation. Developed bone cancer in one of his arms. Had to have his arm cut off at the shoulder. And so he learned how to do all kinds of things with just one hand. And when his children were born and grew up, guess how they did things? With one hand. Because that's what they learned. Oh yeah, there's another way to do it with two hands, but you can do it with one hand. He did a lot of things with one hand. So one of those things wasn't opening a jar, but you know. So, well, it's interesting that the two chapters that most focus on the gifts of the Spirit in the Bible are 1 Corinthians 12 and 1 Corinthians 14. We've already mentioned that in between those two is the love chapter, 1 Corinthians 13. But it's interesting that those chapters were addressed to a Corinthian church fraught with serious spiritual problems. Besides the problems that we know about, such as jealousy, envy, and strife between members, 1 Corinthians 3, 3, and 4, immorality in the church, 1 Corinthians 5, 1, and the church members threatening to take other church members to civil court to solve their problems, 1 Corinthians 6, 1, and even arguments over whether or not it was okay to eat meats or meat that had been offered to idols. The church members in Corinth were apparently abusing their understanding of the Lord's Supper, misusing their spiritual gifts, 1 Corinthians 8, 11, and 14. Why do you suppose that it is in context of such a church that spiritual gifts are most clearly described? Doesn't that seem like, shouldn't Paul have chosen a nice, wonderful church where everything is going just right to talk about spiritual gifts?
Apparently they needed more instruction.
Yeah, they needed more instructions.
Well, sometimes that contrast kind of helps you learn it too. Mm-hmm. When you see a big difference between what you're saying and what's happening around you.
Mm-hmm. So. Okay, yeah. Well, our Bible study guide suggests three things that we need to be really aware of. The sovereign God gives the gifts he chooses to give each one of us. We do not choose the gifts we want, gift or gifts that we want. Two, each person is given at least one gift. He says that very clearly. Three, every gift is for the purpose of building up the body of Christ, his church. So this is not some way to make a big name for ourselves or something. Of course, that would also include reaching out in mission to the community. Ellen White commented, "The present is our day of trust. To every person is committed some peculiar gift or talent which is to be used to advance the Redeemer's kingdom. All God's responsible agents, from the lowliest and most obscure to those in high positions in the church, are entrusted with the Lord's goods. It is not the minister alone who can work for the salvation of souls. Those who have the smallest gifts are not excused from using the very best gifts they have, and in so doing, their talents will be increased. It is not safe to trifle with moral responsibilities, nor to despise the day of small things. God's providence proportions his trusts according to the varied capabilities of the people. None should mourn because they cannot glorify God with talents which they never possessed and for which they are not responsible." Testimonies, Volume 4, page 618. So, Everybody has a gift, and God says, don't be jealous of somebody else using their gift, use your gift. So if each church member would really pray about his gift, try to discover what God has chosen for him to do and do it, what would happen to the church?
It reflects the love of God.
In the joy of that kind of situation, would it be easier for us to forget our selfish ambitions and praise God for what he's doing for the entire church? Are we prepared as individuals to commit our lives to Christ and thank him for the gifts of the Spirit he has given us? Do we need to ask him to reveal to us what gifts we have? Have we tried exercising the gifts which we think we have, which we might have been given? I mean, do you think anybody has ever started out and saying, well, I think I have the gift of whatever it is, prophecy. So he tries exercising that and finds out that he can't do it. It's happened. So what would you do in a situation like that? Try a different gift, right? The Bible in Ellen White suggests that if we are efficiently using the gifts that we have, we may actually be given additional gifts as God sees fit. Do we see affirmation from other church members for the use of our gifts? Could we expect to find true Christian joy in exercising our spiritual gifts in the proper way?
It is more blessed to give than to receive.
Or when we seem to be successful in exercising our spiritual gifts, are we anxious to take the glory to ourselves? Well, a lot of research has been put into figuring out why churches grow. And I'll go through these things very quickly. There are three things that seem to be key. One, people believe in the doctrines and teachings of the group. Two, they become actively involved by serving the group in some way. Three, they become part of a sometimes smaller subset. If it's a big church, it's maybe a smaller subset of the group where they feel a real sense of fellowship. And you have to have two of those three, at least two of those three, or you will leave the church sooner or later. I hope that this has been useful to you. Try out your spiritual gift. Our kind and loving Father, what a privilege it is for us to read your word, to study it, to think about it, to talk about it together like this. May we exercise our spiritual gifts as we discover them and as we realize what a blessing it is to reach out and bless others. The way to bring real joy and peace and happiness is by blessing others. May that be our experience, is our prayer in Jesus' name. Amen.